Whoa. This song's pretty cool.
Yeah, yeah. It sounds like Ozzy. Dun, 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 dun.
If your friends are nerdy and you are nerdy too, I want to talk to you. Friends talking nerdy.
So you want to switch to TV, Tim?
Well, we can, since Morah was not there for the conversation, why not mention another film set during Christmas, Gremlins?
Yeah.
That's on my list.
Yeah. Do you know, I remember seeing it in theater, and I was at camp when that film came out. I think the summer of, I think it was 85, 84, if my memory serves correctly. But yeah, that was a really weird Christmas film. Joe Dante, Spielberg produced it. Really funky film, you know.
Great.
You meet Gizmo, and then there are these three rules that you have to abide by. You know, can't expose them to light. Can't get them wet, and you can't feed them after midnight.
Mm-hmm.
Like there's really weird rules, and incredible.
But remember, they became like the doll version of them. Oh my god, that was huge!
Oh yeah, yeah,
yeah. It was either that or the Cabbage Patch Kids in my grade school.
Wow, that's there's an interesting '80s phase. I mean, I remember those were for like $200 at the time.
That was insane.
And they were just like because they had shortchanged them, so you couldn't find them, and then they were like you knew somebody. Off a truck for $300, and you get the Cabbage Patch Kids in this box that you just wouldn't touch for a collector's item. It's like, oh, I think my mom had one.
Well, I know my mother. Yeah. My mother would probably go buy she would buy a fake one that would be called like a Gromlin, and say, "Here you go. This is what you're getting."
That's great.
That's funny.
That's great.
Wow.
But yeah, we can transition to TV. Why not bring up the most epic holiday special in television history, the Star Wars Holiday Special?
With Chewbacca's family, right?
For the first 15 minutes.
I kind of remember a glimpse of it.
I may have to
YouTube that and watch that. I really remember that.
It's on YouTube. The premise is Han and Chewie are heading back to Kashyyyk because it's Life Day, yet the Empire stops them. The first 15 minutes of the show is you're seeing Chewie's wife and children. They're all speaking Wookiee, and there's no translations. You get B. Arthur singing. You get Jefferson's Starship, High on Cocaine singing.
Oh, my God.
Art Carney's in it. Carrie Fisher sings. The amount of cocaine they had to pull that off.
Wow.
Yeah, when we're done recording, go to YouTube. It is well worth the watch.
Yeah.
Okay, definitely. Harrison Ford was in it, so all the cast was in that, right?
Yep. And that's the funny thing about Mark Hamill, too. When you initially see him, he looks like one of those people that had like way too many plastic surgeries and starts looking like a human doll.
Well, didn't he get into a car accident? I thought that's what happened.
A little bit after that, but during this recording, this was before the scar on his face.
Oh, wow. Okay. Wow. Okay.
That's crazy.
Well, we're talking about episodes for TV. I got to say, you guys brought up Night Court, but the episode, I think, when Harry meets his father. Is that the one?
With John Astin, yeah.
Yeah, this one because he said...
You played him?
John Astin played, and his, you know, his father was in a mental asylum.
Oh my God, that's right.
And it was, and I can't, the episode I remember, I think it's the one, it's been a minute, but towards the end, I think Harry didn't believe in Santa Claus, and the ending shot is basically his father is in a car outside the window of Santa Claus, and like the car's hovering and takes off. I remember, it just was, oh man, I was just, oh, that was so funny. I gotta watch that again. That's a good episode.
And John Astin, John Astin, amazing actor. I always loved in that show when he would always give that line, but I'm feeling much better.
Much
now.
Better. Oh, that's a great 80s show. I'm glad you guys called that out. That's probably one of my favorite 80s shows. The first three seasons of the show were good. First season was really good because of Selma Diamond, and there was a lot of detail, but towards the season 3 or 4, they started whittling down a little bit.
Well, I was upset when she died.
So Selma Diamond, Yeah, she's... she was around, well, smoke cigarettes will do that to you.
No. All right, so for TV shows, I brought up on my list Friends. I have to, because like they keep showing all the reruns on TV, and they've done so many funny holiday ones, especially the Thanksgiving one. And when, so like, what was it? Like there was one where Monica wears a turkey on the head to cheer up Chandler. You find out, you know, how they initially met, like Ross brings him over to the house when they were in college, which was always hysterical. But like one of my favorite ones was the one where everybody kind of has plans, but they still are forced to eat together. And Monica and Ross's parents are there, which beautifully played by Elliot Gould and Christina Pickles, which, by the way, you know, Christina Pickles, the one who plays the mother, was in He-Man.
Really?
The movie.
Oh,
yeah. She was the good sorceress who gets captured by Skeletor.
Wow. Frank Langella. Frank Langella, one of the finest actors of our time, still credits that movie as one of his favorite performances.
Really? Wow. Yep. You know, if you see that, he really gets can Shakespearean playing Skeletor.
Yes.
I think you're right, Tim. He's like, you know what, I have nothing to lose. I'm going to play Skeletor as this really powerful being who really wants to take over the universe. And he played it that way.
He did. He totally did.
And the thing to think about that film, too, is the writer and director, Gary Goddard, his influence was not the Masters of the Universe from the toys or the cartoons. His influence was actually the New Gods, the Jack Kirby story that he came up with DC Comics. So if you're a fan of the New Gods, you can see a lot more similarities in that story in Masters of the Universe than you can the actual He-Man storyline.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Did not know.
Yeah, neither
did I. The more you know.
Dun, dun, dun. So going back to the episode with Friends. So the parents are over. Rachel made her trifle, and she did it wrong. She put meat in it. Joey wants to go see his roommate and dance with her girlfriends. So him and Ross are trying to get out, and Monica has to tell the parents that Chandler is... living with her now, and for whatever reason, Phoebe now has a crush on the father. So it's just like the way that whole episode plays out was just hysterical. So that was just one of my favorite ones.
No, I wasn't a fan of the Friends show. I mean, I have good friends that saw it, but there's some episodes of it I have watched. But for that show, I'm just a fan of I'm drawing a blank on her name right now. She dated Conan O'Brien.
Courtney Cox?
No.
Lisa Kudrow.
Lisa Kudrow. I think she's the only one that won an Emmy for the show, but I think she was the best performance on that show.
Her and Joey were my two favorite characters.
Yeah, I think as for just when I was a big fan of the show, but for her, I was like, okay. Yeah.
I would say with Lisa Kudrow, she, in a lot of ways, and I mean this in a good sense, she's reminds me a lot of Tommy Chong. In Friends, and how she how she betrayed Phoebe, she had a wonderful honesty about how not smart Phoebe actually was, but thought she was, I guess. And in a lot of ways, it does remind me of how Tommy Chong is able to pull off his character that he's pulled off his whole life.
Okay. When Friends comes on and reruns on TBS, I'll sit down and watch it. I'll give it a shot.
Lisa Kudrow lucked out on that because she actually, her character was the most interesting one of them all.
Oh,
because of her background.
Mm.
Like the background of the character.
Mm.
You know, like the mother committed suicide. She has a twin she doesn't talk to. She lived on the street at some point. She's an artist. She's just a total whack job, but she's a survivor. She's awesome.
Yeah, that twin that she doesn't talk to, it may refer... She played a waitress character in that TV show Mad About You.
And which was awesome. I love how they connected it.
Yeah,
that's what I was going to say. Yeah. When Friends came around, they made them either cousins or sisters, so...
Yeah. Mad About You was a good 90s show. Didn't get the much deserved credits for it, but that was a good 90s show.
Yeah.
All right. Any TV show for you?
Well, I said Night Court.
Oh, that's right. You did. Okay, yeah. So
Tim? You're going to Tim. So back to you.
Yeah, that's right. Well, for me, when I grew up, my lovely Aunt Sharon, who lives in a town called Christmas, Michigan now and owns a store called Santa's Workshop, she adored Christmas. And that got me very cynical at a very early age. It was an overdose of Christmas for me. So the types of holiday stuff that I end up watching on television are more along the lines of what you find on South Park. And my favorite holiday South Park episode, Red Sleigh Down. When Cartman, who goes to his naughty and nice lawyer, and finds out that he needs to essentially to have peace in the Middle East in order to be on Santa's nice list to get the robot that he wants for Christmas.
Oh my God, that's funny!
Yeah, convinces Santa to go to Iraq and give the kids gifts, but Santa gets shot down. The kids get Mr. Hankey to help out, and then Mr. Hankey brings them to the Vatican to get Jesus. And Jesus and the gang head to Iraq, and one of my favorite scenes is near the beginning when Jesus, they land on a roof, and Iraqi guards come out with guns, and Jesus goes, "I'll take care of this." And then he goes over with his hands raised and goes, "My brothers, you must know one thing. I'm packing." Stabs one guy, takes his gun, and shoots the other guy. And then they rescue Santa. They rescue Santa after Santa was shocked in the testicles with a car battery. And then Jesus ends up taking a bullet for Santa. And the whole end of the story is Santa bringing the kids back to South Park and saying that once a year you should honor Jesus for making the ultimate sacrifice on this day.
Oh my God!
Oh man, I always think about to the famous episode, the famous short that came out with Santa finding Jesus. That just before South Park got big.
That's funny. That's the one that started it all with South Park, and that's the one I could not find it. I remember being at Comic-Con and trying to hunt it down, and like I found it on a VHS tape, but the quality was so crappy I wouldn't buy it because they were showing they were trying to show it, and I'm like, that's awful, I can't even make it out or hear it properly. So I never got to see it.
I think didn't Clooney hire them to do that special thing, and then it just got out in the open?
No, it was a Paramount executive who hired them to remake The Spirit of Christmas because they initially did it in 92. Both those clips should be on YouTube now. But the one they did in 95 was essentially the show as we see it today.
Right.
Yeah, so it was essentially the first viral video before anybody knew what a viral video was.
Mm, yeah.
But yeah, that show, what they've done too with the music, like they released a whole Christmas album, Mr. Hankey's Christmas Classics.
Oh my God, I bought that for my father. He loved it. It was awesome. That was a really good album.
I don't know if they included the duet with Jesus and Santa, where Santa ends up singing, "Her name is Rio and she dances on the sand." There's one for the greatest hits of the show.
That's great, Tim.
Some of the music too, like in the original Mr. Hankey episode, I love that little song that Kyle Broflowski did, "It's Hard to Be a Jew on Christmas." I mean, there was a lot of emotion to that.
That was great.
I'll give those guys credit, man. They when you watch that show, for that time, that show was just like, we don't care, we're just gonna do what we gotta do and just make fun of everybody.
And speaking of which, since you brought it up, because I was talking to my my friend Clay in Portland, who, by the way, is still waiting for you to release more episodes on YouTube so you can watch it. just throwing it out there, Tim.
I'm so sorry.
You should be. Because I was telling him that we were doing this and, you know, I was trying to put a list together. And I'm like, and he was like, what about Hanukkah movies? And I'm like, oh, my God, you're being a Jew. I should know this. And it's like there really is not any good Hanukkah movies I can say, like anything going on. TV shows or, well, Friends, of course, tried. But no, I mean, I don't even want to mention Adam Sandler's Eight Crazy Nights. No, we're not talking about that. But anything else, like, you know, like if we talk about like Die Hard and Lethal Weapon and all that, it's like, no one really says, it's like, oh, look, there's Hanukkah in the background.
Well, you know, I think you're right. I can't think of any.
Yeah, I couldn't.
I can't. I can't think of anything. When I think of Adam Sandler, I thought about the Christmas song when he sung it on the show.
Yeah.
That's. I can't think of any Hanukkah movie.
Yeah. That, you stumped me there, man.
I guess we gotta do it then. We haven't got a Hanukkah movie then.
That's right. I'm so sad.
The story of Hanukkah with Jason Statham. No.
Yeah, because like if you Google it, yeah, Eight Crazy Nights come up and the Hebrew Hammer. Like, oh my God. The Hebrew Hammer. How hysterical is that?
Well, what famous, what TV show reminds you of the holidays the most?
TV show. Oh, wow. This, you know, well, you know, I'm a big MASH fan. And there are a couple of episodes of MASH that did that. There was the one I remember clearly was it's like season seven or eight or nine. So this is during the Charles Emerson Winchester, and the episode basically is for his family tradition. Is he would give his family was like it was just was like an anonymous gift he would give to the orphans. So I got some chocolate. But the head of the orphanage took the chocolate and sold it for rice and cabbage. And Winchester gets mad at him. He says, well, look, your gift would have been great for a moment. But by me selling it, we had food for a month. And it just, that show really was reflection. The movie was reflection of Vietnam because the film came out. But the show, I'm a big MASH fan. So I've seen all the TV show like thousands of times, episodes. But that episode really just got me because while that's going on, Hawkeye, BJ, and Hot Lips are helping a patient who's going through stuff, who's actually trying to see if they can save his life. But what happens is that, you know, he dies. So what Hawkeye does goes, look, see, he survived. He died the day after Christmas. So it's one of those shows. I mean, this is when they got rid of the laugh track, and the show towards like the last three seasons got really serious. It really got more depth into topics. And that, when I think of Christmas and TV shows like that, that episode really sticks out to me. Next to the Archie Bunker on the Family episode. But that one really sticks out to me for a really good TV Christmas episode. I mean, every TV show that we grew up watching or out now has that one episode that really just rings. Like Simpsons did it a couple of years ago with multiple episodes.
Yeah, Simpsons did a lot. A
lot of that stuff. And the Family Guy did that. And I think Bob's Burgers is going to probably do one again. Well, so they're all out there. I'm wondering if your show, The Orville, is going to do a Christmas episode.
We got two more episodes to find out. But speaking, I mean, you mentioned it, The Simpsons. Their first episode was a Christmas special. It wasn't officially the first episode.
Stan's a little helper.
Yeah.
No, sorry. Quick little side note, since you brought up The Orville, because I know the last time, Tim, you and I had the podcast, you mentioned Orville, Priya.
Yeah.
The one with Charlize Theron, which I finally saw, which I was, that was really cool. I thought that was cool that she was on it. And I kind of liked the plot, but I realized we have to have, at some point, we're going to have a discussion. The topic is going to be time travel. because I was not happy with the ending with that, and it made me realize it's like, oh my god, we can talk for hours about movies and TV shows who either did an amazing job or sucked it. Like, it just, like, too many loopholes. Like, what were they thinking? It's like, that can't happen because this happened, you know? So it's, that's going to be an interesting topic. So just little, you know, things to come for us to talk about.
Well, why not touch upon it now? Because another TV show that dealt with time travel, that dealt with sci-fi elements, that is notorious for their Christmas episodes, Doctor Who.
Oh, yeah. Yay. Good one. I totally forgot about that.
Yeah, this, I'm not, I know of the show, so I'm not as a deep fan as you two of that show. So,
so good.
I got BBC America. I got to catch up. I know there's a whole... is this the one with David? Was Tennant the Doctor Who at the time of the Christmas special?
No, so every year they come out, whoever the Doctor is. So, right. Like, you'll have the series.
Right.
And then there'll just be one special by itself. It's like a Christmas, like, they'll just do a separate one.
Okay.
But it'll have, like, a holiday theme to it, which is awesome. I love it.
Doctor Who, gotcha.
Good call, Tim. Totally forgot about that.
Yeah, I mean, David Tennant, his first episode as a Doctor was the Christmas special between Series 1 and Series 2, which was a perfect introduction to his character. And just so much, and also David Tennant's last episode, what did they call it? The Time of the Doctor? No, The End of Time with a guest star, Timothy Dalton. Watching it was a two-parter, watching those two episodes and David Tennant regenerating into the Matt Smith era Doctor. One of those just so well done, so perfect, amazing music choices. I mean, Murray Gold, who did the music on that show, should be a lot more famous than he is, because that ending music they have for the Doctor was just amazing. One of those emotional ones that bring tears to your eyes type of deal. So
yeah, but the thing is, it was for me, it's funny, like some of those I have to be honest, some of them were hit or miss, where it's like either like I absolutely loved it, or it's like it just was too depressing and I was like, no, didn't care for it.
Well, which ones did you not like?
I'm trying to remember. I don't remember. I know there was The Town Called Christmas, which I don't think I was a fan of. Yeah. There was one that was similar to Scrooge, where it's like, so he went back and, like, do you remember that one? I don't remember what that was called.
Yeah, I forgot the name of it, but I think that was A World Called Christmas or something, but it was the guy who ended up playing Dumbledore in the last few Harry Potter movies was the Scrooge character.
Michael Gambon?
What was that?
Michael Gambon.
Yeah, it was him. He was the Scrooge character, but then the Doctor came back because I guess it was confusing, to be honest. I can't recall everything specifically, but it was just one of those back and forth type of deals. I mean, it was enjoyable at the time, but definitely not the best Christmas special. I do prefer the ones during the Russell T. Davies era. Stephen Moffat, just really not my cup of tea for what he did with the Doctor. I prefer his work on Sherlock much more.
You know, it's funny. I was thinking about Christmas episodes, and if you guys are doing cartoons, the real Ghostbusters, when they caught the Ghostbusters past, present, and future, and they had to go in and find them, and they literally, and basically, I think it was Egon and Ray. No, Egon and I'm drawing blank on Ghostbusters. I think it was Winston and Egon had to go, and Bill Murray's character. Why?
Hold on, it's on the tip of my tongue also.
Venkman. Yeah, those three had to go and find the original ghost, and Ray literally had like an etch a sketch or like the viewing thing on Evans' face, and he has him in a chair and he's running around trying to convince him about that. When I saw that, that blew my mind, because the episode starts off, they get a call, they capture these ghosts, and the next day it's like, what happened to Christmas? Like, uh-oh, we caught the, because Scrooge never had Fathom Christmas ended, and I was so blown away that they did that. Hysterical. That aired on a that aired like at prime time.
Wow,
it's called The Real Ghostbusters Christmas Carol. That was a great episode, man. I remember that was crazy.
That's funny. I didn't see that one.
Yeah, that's I remember that because literally Ray's like, okay, and it really goes, yeah, and literally he's running around the house. He has Ebenezer in his chair, and he's running around the room, and it cuts to the other guy, Ghostbusters in the containment unit trying to get him out, and other ghosts are like, wait a minute, they're in here, we can get out with them, and they're trying to find those three ghosts, and it happens all over again. It was crazy.
And that was in prime time?
Yeah, I remember seeing that on prime time. I think that aired prime time just for that, because when that cartoon came out, it was so huge. Because it was the Ghostbusters and the real Ghostbusters, right? The real Ghostbusters had the original characters in Slimer, and then the Ghostbusters one, I think, was a Filmation one where it was like an ape and two other guys that caught ghosts, but it was a really cheesy ripoff.
I actually, believe it or not, it wasn't. That came out in the 70s.
Really?
Yeah, the Ivan Reitman had and his crew had to license out the Ghostbusters name, and the only reason they brought it back as a cartoon was to piggyback off the success of the Dan Aykroyd Ghostbusters.
Really?
Yep.
Learn something new every day.
There you go.
That's funny.
Yeah, hilarious.
So what about you, Morah?
Well, I'm going to bring it back to movies since I don't really have any other TV shows.
Well.
So I'm going to mention your favorite person in the world, Tim.
Oh, God.
Elf.
I knew you were going to say that.
You knew. Yeah.
Yeah.
Tim loves Will Ferrell.
Really? Will Ferrell fan, huh?
God, no. Just makes no effort whatsoever, and how
he. Did you see the last film he did with him and Amy Poehler?
No,
the I last on a date. The one with their daughter. They have no money.
Oh my god! So no, I didn't see that. I want to see it.
That's you know, Tim. I know you're not a big Will Ferrell. I know you're not a big Will Ferrell fan, but this is one of those films you just go. It's a train wreck, but it's such a great train wreck.
No, I think the last film I saw him in was Gene and Silent Bob Strike Back.
Wow, really? You haven't seen any other Will Ferrell movies?
But didn't you see it in, he was in the Lego movie. You didn't see that?
Did not see it.
Wow.
Okay.
I mean, I let my kids.
The Lego movie, that was great.
I mean, I let my kids watch it. I'm not going to be that much of an asshole, but they're going to hear that I hate Will Ferrell.
You're an asshole, Tim. Seriously. Come on.
Wow. Oh, okay. I know that's something that's in that one. Ooh, Elf. Yeah, you know, I think, you know what happened? It's like a Christmas Story, right? When you first see a Christmas Story, the very first time, it's a good film, but it's become that film now. Every Christmas Eve, Christmas Day, TBS and TNT.
Oh my God, right? Yeah.
It's like just repeat. And I love, Christmas Story is a great film. When I first saw it, I thought it was a really great Christmas film, but it's so oversaturated, like Elf. And Elf is actually a funny film, but it's just, but I mean, you know,
with Elf, what's funny, I saw it in the movie theater, same thing, I wasn't laughing my ass off at it, and I was like, okay, you know, there's a couple of funny scenes, but then when I start watching it on TV, mm-hmm. it's like the more I watch it, the more it's like, okay, this is growing on me,
right? Yeah.
So it was funny.
Yeah,
but yeah, I don't know.
It could be the Citizen Kane of comedy, you know.
Tell us how you really feel, Tim.
Yeah, really. How do you really feel about Will Ferrell?
All right, moving on. Who's next?
I'm trying to think. I guess I. Man, TV. Okay. Shoot, we're gonna do some cartoons. How about Fat Albert Christmas?
Okay.
Good one.
There's a one. Let's see if I. Oh man, it's been a minute since that one. Yeah, I think the kids are trying to celebrate Christmas. Was that the one Mudbone? Man, I can't. You know, it's been a minute since I saw that.
Richard Pryor was on that show?
No. Richard Pryor. No, there's a character named Mudbone that Bill Cosby voiced. He was a homeless dude that lived outside a junkyard, and the front door was a refrigerator.
Well, Richard,
so you open up and it's like, oh, Mudbone's door is a refrigerator. Oh man! Wow! Ooh, I gotta, I may have to come back to me on that one, because I think, I don't know if that's the one where Mudbone gets sick. There's one episode where he gets sick and he's in the hospital. I'm trying to bring the show to down, but that's I.
Happy
that's
holidays. One,
that's.
Yeah,
that's why, you know, that's I mean, with cartoons at the 80s at the time, that was one of my favorite cartoon shows. And did a Fat Albert Christmas. That's a really, I gotta, it's been a minute. That's a, yeah.
Well, the reason I bring that up, Mudbone was also a character that Richard Pryor used in his stand-up act.
Yes, yeah, yeah. I know, if you have that album, Something I Said, that's the one that he's in. Yeah, Mudbone.
Okay, so what about you, Tim? What's your next one?
The Beavis and Butthead Christmas Special. Yeah, with Santa Butthead reading letters to Santa from his sack.
That funny.
Yeah. You said sack.
Great, I'm hanging out 5-year-olds.
it was going to get there someday.
Yeah, I know.
My favorite little bit from that is when they redid the Christmas Carol, and Coach Buzzcut is the ghost of Christmas future, and he has Beavis at his grave, and his gravestone was, "Here lies Beavis. He never scored." And he okay, and Beavis was getting to the point where he kind of realizes what's going on, but then Butthead wakes him up, and then Beavis, the only lesson he learned was that he was going to grow up and be an assistant manager at Burger World, and he was going to have a VCR and some porn.
Nice.
Yeah, and then of course the music videos in between. I mean, their commentary on Christmas and Hollis is classic, and they also that Christmas song. They did their own little metal version of it, which was funny.
What Christmas song was that?
Damn it.
No clue what you're doing. It almost sounded like Sports Center, but anyways. That's what I keep hearing every time you did that. Alright.
Checking out my YouTube history, but what about, since I brought up videos and music, what about Christmas music?
Oh my god. No, we're not going there.
And with that, another episode of Friends Talking Nerdy is in the books. We'd like to thank you all for downloading and listening to episode 19 of our podcast. I can't believe we're up to episode 19. It seemed like yesterday that I conferred with a couple of friends, and we talked about what if we put together a podcast. And here we go, 19 episodes later. I don't know. It feels like a dream. I'm glad. I mean, even though it's not the biggest audience in the world, I'm glad that we got people listening on a somewhat consistent basis. So thanks again, everybody. Next week will be part 3 of the holiday special. As always, we here at Friends Talking Nerdy would love to thank Christopher Lazarek for his wonderful theme song. You can head to his website, ChristopherLazarek.com, for all the information you need on how to purchase his EP called Here's to You, which is available on all digital platforms. As well as just basic information about Christopher and his career. He's a good guy. Helped this show out when he did not need to. And just anything you can do. If you are a fan of this show, you are going to go to his website and buy his album. Stream it if you have to, but buy it first. And anyway, with that, we leave you with this. Oh, and one more thing. Since it's the holidays, my youngest son decided he was going to spend some time with his old dad. Still, he's not a teenager yet, and I expect when he gets to be a teenager, he'll be all emotional and probably not want to talk to me for a while. But hey, that's a different story for a different day. But I was going to ask him if he wanted to be on the show, but he got nervous. He got so nervous he ended up falling asleep. But I told him he would be on. So what you're going to hear next is his interest in being on this podcast.
That's Luke, everybody. All right, with that, we leave you with this. And once again, join us next week for another episode of Friends Talking Nerdy. Remember to subscribe to the podcast. Head to our website, friendstalkingnerdy.com. You can find me on Twitter at Tim Jousma. Yeah, we'll see you next week.
He said, "You are to be the Virgin Mother," and Mary thought that was weird.
"No, son, I don't know what I want."
But then Gabriel said to Mary, "My child, have no fear. And still be a virgin, Mary! And still not be considered flawed.
Oh, no, you're not told to. I'm faithful to the bone.
You're still a virgin in the eyes of God." There was no room at the inn when Mary and Joseph did arrive. They were so very tired, you see. Since she had no money, Gabriel appeared to Mary and told her not to weep. And still be a virgin, Mary! And still be the mother of Christ. If there's no room at the inn, then it's not considered a sin. That's right. Then three wise men did appear, bearing gifts of myrrh and such. They said that they had followed a star and missed a woman's touch.
No,
but again Gabriel appeared to her, and this is what he said.
Everyone
in the nation.
Hello, hello.